All right, why don't we start? That actually wasn't a question. I meant it rhetorically. Okay, so we begin our first panel, and to do so, I want to do two things. One is I want to clear up a misconception from Pat Fitzgerald. He talked about New York having 5 district attorneys, 2 U.S. attorneys, and a special narcotics prosecutor. He left out a couple. And so we take a look at the New York metropolitan area, and we see the 5 district attorneys in each of the counties. There's also Nassau, Suffolk, there's Westchester, Fairfield. So if we're looking at something in and around the port of New York, we can see all of the counties in New Jersey as well. Each of them has a district attorney. There are, in this little area, 4 U.S. attorneys, Eastern, Southern, District of Connecticut, and District of New Jersey. There is the Organized Crime Task Force as a separate prosecutor along with the Special Narcotics Prosecutor. There are federal departments, and you can think of FBI, DEA, ICE, Border Protection, IRS, INS, ATF, Inspectors General in several of the agencies. You can look at state investigations, so you have state police in the 3 states. You have local police departments, 1 for New York City, you have 1 for Nassau, you have 62 in Westchester. And then there are others along here. If we flip the switch in a quick, just on that map alone, and I'm sure I'm leaving out a number, all of these prosecutors, all of these investigators and law enforcement agencies, and in terms of task forces, you conclude the Organized Crime Task Force, OSADEF, in terms of investigative bodies and police departments, you can include Port Authority Police, the Waterfront Commission Police, and so on. And you add all of those together, and that's the question of coordination. So, let's begin with a little story, and then we'll move on to the panel. The story occurs in the 1960s. A man by the name of James Marcus became the water commissioner under John Lindsay. He was totally unqualified for the position and had it only because he worked on Lindsay's campaign. The water commissioner ensures that all of the water supply to the city of New York and surrounding areas is acceptable water and there's enough of it. It is a big job. It also is one that allows the commissioner to let out contracts, and particularly on an emergency basis, because anything dealing with water is going to be in an emergency, which means a no-bid contract. The water commissioner, during the course of the campaign, had met a man named Herbert Itkin. Herbert Itkin was a part-time FBI informant. He was an informant in the sense that he would do bad things, and every time he got caught, he'd turn in everybody else. but he had a relationship with the FBI. He had convinced Marcus, who had married a very wealthy woman, he had no money of his own, that he needed to get some money to have some self-respect and to invest in the stock called Extra through a brokerage house. And he should do so on margin. Of course, the stock went down, and Itkin's advice was buy more. He bought more, the stock went down, he was in serious trouble, and so Itkin introduced him to the mob, who then lent him money once he was willing to steer contracts to the mob-connected companies. Eventually, he was investigated by the Manhattan DA's office. As soon as the subpoenas went out, he told Itkin. Itkin took him by the hand, brought him over to the FBI and the Southern District of New York. The Southern District made the case. The Manhattan DA's office, who had initiated the investigation, yelled and screamed to very little avail. And the district attorney, Frank Hogan, wound up not talking to the US attorney, Bob Morgan, for about a decade. So we begin. Paul Sheckman, I'm not going to make you Herbert Itkin. but close to it. You're a defense attorney representing somebody who is being investigated by the, let's say, Manhattan DA's office. You think you can do better in the Southern District of New York. Do you take the case to them? Oh, I thought this was, you're not supposed to know anything about this. I didn't talk to you beforehand.
Okay. Someone asked me to tell the story of the Marissa Baritas case, which relates to that. It's not quite how Ron has it, but I'll tell it to you, and I'll try to do it pretty quickly, but it gives a very good sense of state-federal tensions. Marissa Baritas's job at, I think, Morgan Stanley was to make sure that no one traded on inside information. And my sense is she did that job quite well, except that she traded on inside information, which is to say she tipped her boyfriend about mergers and acquisitions. He was arrested on a separate crime. Like all good boyfriends, he flipped on her. And she was taped, and I went down to listen to the tape, and the tape included this sentence. She said to him, "You have to understand, I'm breaching my fiduciary duty." It's true. I said to her, "If you do this again, say in violation of 10b-5, you might as well just..." but still, it wasn't a good tape. Because his crime had been a state crime, and he flipped, this was a state prosecution, and unusual in that it was a state insider trading prosecution under the Martin Act. It became clear to me that Mary Jo White, who was the U.S. attorney at the time, and who, as you know, was very territorial, picked her fights carefully. She didn't. I mean, she had a sense of what her territory was. And if you encroached on it, it was important to her to make clear it was her territory. I got a call from the head of her securities fraud unit saying that they were going to bring charges against Ms. Baritas. The goal was to double jeopardy out the state. I needn't worry. They didn't intend to hurt her. They asked if she could cooperate against anyone. I took the emphasis to be on the anyone. Part of it. We found somebody we could cooperate against. And the next thing I knew, there was a federal information filed charging her with insider trading. The day it was filed, I think I can tell this part of the story too, my partner Charlie Stillman, who is here, was down at Bob Morgenthau's office, and Bob Morgenthau said to him, "After what you did today, you're no longer welcome here." Charlie had done nothing. I mean, I had gotten the phone call, and really, I did nothing other than to say yes. Charlie called me from the car and said, "Quick, can we sell our state court practice?" And that's how bad a moment it was for the firm. Marissa Baritas's next act was to plead guilty to the federal charges. John Moskow, who was here, will remember this part of the story because he and Jim Kindler, who was the number two at the district attorney's office, showed up in magistrate's court in the Southern District to try to block the plea. And they, I think Jim spoke and said, if this plea is allowed to go through, it will double jeopardy out our state case. Because while there's a dual sovereign doctrine that normally would allow separate prosecutions by separate sovereigns, there is a New York statute that clearly, if there was a federal prosecution, would bar this state prosecution. So Jim said, if you allow this to go forward, it will double jeopardy out our state case. The federal prosecutor said to the judge, "I move to strike those remarks. He does not have standing to be in this proceeding." I said to the judge, "I'm with the federal prosecutor on most of this, but I don't move to strike those. I would ask that he repeat those words." she got probation, the state case was double jeopardied out, and my relationship with that office, the state office, suffered for a good period of time as a result. Those of you who know Bob Morgenthau know that he doesn't hold a grudge for long, not normally more than a couple decades.
Paul, supposing you had not gotten the call, but you realized that you could make a better deal for your client by going federal, would you do so?
Yes. I mean, look, it's...
Okay,
it's,
that's all I need.
That's
Harry Littman, you are the federal prosecutor. Paul comes to you with his client and says, we are being investigated by the local district attorney, but I think I can do better with you. I'm willing to give you the entire case. Do you take it?
Well, first, I want to, Paul, I think, has laid out three ways that I hope I won't and that the system overall, Paul's laid out three ways that I hope I won't and the system overall won't make the decision. The first is just by sort of surprise drop, as happened in the case Pat related as well, where somebody without consultation just quickly acts to change the facts on the ground. Happens a fair bit, though, and that's one of the principal reasons for the ongoing working group approach that's grown over the last many years, some of which creates sort of dreary weekly or monthly meetings, but nevertheless keeps that kind of shenanigans from happening too much. Second way I don't want to do it with respect to Paul is just based on the happenstance of a defense attorney, basically based on the defendant's interests. I want to take myself as being the lookout for the federal interest and seeing what's involved and how it's going to be best served. And third, with respect to Judge Johnson, I don't want to do it in court either. And by having someone show up and get a judicial fiat that says one person goes or the other person goes. What I'd like to do, and if I've got the kind of relationship that Morgenthau and Hogan or Morgenthau and Mary Jo White apparently didn't have, is that when I know there's some involvement on the state side, is I want to be doing it by picking up the phone and having a conversation with...
I'll do the conversation. Can we have the case? No.
Can we? Okay. Well, so that's not final. First of all, we've got a regular relationship. If that's how it's played, I mean, my approach to this will be first, I do want to be the guy in the room and in the system who's been put in a lucky position as U.S. attorney where I'm not looking to move up to the next stage. I don't have political pressures on me. I want, in the same way, I want to be sensitive to it and be somewhat deferential. But I want to create a system almost in a kind of game theory way where I'll play fair first, but if my state colleague doesn't play fair back, then maybe we act.
You've acted.
Okay, I've acted how? I've taken the case?
You've taken the case.
Okay, I'm in.
Dan, you are the chief assistant in the district attorney's office. What do you do?
Well, first let me give the disclaimer that I was not in the DA's office when this case happened, although I was a federal prosecutor across the river, and I do remember thinking that it was not very sporting of the Southern District to do that. And
yes, because it went to the Southern District, not the Eastern District.
But the serious point is that the spectacle of two assistant DAs standing up in front of a magistrate protesting a federal prosecution is something one would hope that we can avoid in the future. It's not an ideal state of affairs. I agree you have to pick up the phone. And I would like to think that from my point of view where I sit today, that because there's a strong state interest in enforcement of our blue sky laws, which after all predate the Securities and Exchange Act of 1934, that the Southern District would would at a minimum not jeopardy us out. I concede the federal interest, but I would try to negotiate a way in which we could both continue with our prosecutions.
And how would you do that? I mean, in effect, they want to allow the defendant to get probation. You don't want to agree to that. That's the way they think that they can get cooperation. You don't care whether she cooperates with the feds. You want her to cooperate with you. How do you work this out?
I'd be surprised if she was promised probation in the federal system. I don't know the facts, Paul, but I assume that was not a promise.
Was not.
Yeah, so she
just happened to wind up with probation.
So she had a 5K, presumably, and she was cooperating. I've done it as a federal prosecutor. I've done it as a state prosecutor, and it's a matter of negotiation and timing. Look, at the end of the day, Ron, you're going to ask me, what if the Manhattan DA is insisting on jail and the U.S. attorney wants probation? And, that's a very tough circumstance. And I would hope that we have the kind of relationship where we can work something like that out.
You don't.
We do. I hope we do today.
Yeah, it would be nice. We could all, we don't have to have this panel because we could all say everybody gets along and there is no federal state competition. But there is, and it happened in the two cases we talked about. So what do you do?
Well, then let me back up and give you some sort of general principles that we think about in these things. That, you know, the concept of sweat equity is big in these kind of turf battles, and you want to at least ask the question so you have a persuasive argument. Who was handling the investigation? If it's really true, as the newspapers reported, that the Southern District had no case on Ms. Baridis, then the Manhattan DA really has a very good argument to say, you know, butt out. This is a case that we've been working. If you insist on staying in, I agree that we can negotiate a carve out so that you won't jeopardy us out. That can be done by, as a matter of timing.
Okay.
Or something.
They're not agreeable to that. The case goes before Judge Sterling Johnson. Are you going to appear?
The Manhattan DA?
Yeah.
No. We don't have standing.
Judge Johnson?
Doesn't mean we wouldn't make a public statement. Doesn't mean we wouldn't send a stern letter or a stern missive, and doesn't mean we wouldn't involve the press and the public. But certainly I would not appear in front of Judge Johnson as an assistant DA and try to intervene in a federal prosecution.
Judge Johnson, before you took the bench, I take it you had some small number of cases that dealt with state, federal jurisdiction?
I have.
Do those happy memories inform you as a judge as to how you would handle this case if an objection was made to you about the federal government moving in on what appeared to be a state case?
I would reminisce about the wars that I was involved in, both as a state prosecutor and as a federal prosecutor. How I was screwed as a state prosecutor. How I screwed the federal prosecutor. And I'd sit back and I'd smile.
But when it came time to ruling, do you see any standing by the state to object to what appears to be a federal takeover of a state case?
No, they have no standing at all. And that's the only thing that would concern me.
Would it affect your judgment as to whether or not to give the defendant probation if the state objected to it?
No. We don't even have the 5K letter yet, so I don't know whether I would give probation anyway.
Okay. Do you think, once this is put before you, when you sat there reminiscing, do you have any wisdom to impart to the state and federal prosecutors as to how they ought to be making these decisions?
Well, I think that they should have had not a meeting, but as the bad guys say, a sit down prior to this situation arising, and have a mechanism or procedure to resolve a situation such as this before it came to this.
Well, in a sense, that would be fine, but it's not very easy. I mean, the Southern District is saying we are the people that are handling securities fraud cases, and we ought to do it in every case, no matter what the state is interested in, because it is a federal issue involving federal financial system and economy. And the state says, look, we are New York, and this is the headquarters for all of the financial institutions, or lots of them, and we need to ensure that the state interest is vindicated.
Well, first of all, I would inform the state they have no standing. But I'd also inform both parties that they have to sit down and resolve the situation. I would have, as a judge, don't have a nickel in that quarter. But they have got to resolve that situation. If not, what's going to happen? The feds are going to screw the state this time. And then the state, when they get an opportunity, they're going to screw the feds the next time. And I know I've done it. And it's the bad guys who are going to win.
Katie LeMaire, you are the counsel to the head of the police commissioner in New York.
Yes.
And you are both a user of prosecutorial services, but you're also a supplier of cases to them. And you realize that you have state or local opportunities. Do you use that to your advantage?
Can you be more specific?
Yeah. Do you decide to take a case to one or the other, depending upon what aims you want to achieve?
I think...
Or do you play one off against another in order for them to take cases that you would like them to take?
Well, I came to this conference thinking to myself, you know, I've gone to these kinds of things, and I've watched panelists talk, and I've seen, you know, who's entertaining, who's not, what flies, what doesn't, how do people get carried away. And so I thought to myself before coming here, A, I shouldn't tell war stories, because people tend to go on far too long with those. And two, B, no mudslinging, no dirtying up anyone, because as counsel to Ray Kelly, we're working with everybody, so I certainly don't want to alienate anyone. I see that those rules have been set aside so far from the keynote.
You're free to go. All restraints are taken off.
From the keynote speaker down to virtually everyone who has spoken so far at this table. But to be truthful, given rules, given jurisdictional rules venue, with the police department, the issue is not so much one state prosecutor, one DA versus another. What comes into play more, honestly, is one federal prosecutor versus another federal prosecutor. And perhaps, frankly, to a lesser degree, federal versus state prosecutor. These issues come into play in terrorism investigations, perhaps. Well, they do. And I was actually very surprised when I came to work at the NYPD to see the relations that have developed over the course of the last 8 or 9 years between the intelligence division of the NYPD and one unnamed federal prosecutor versus the other. And what was the question?
You see yourself as a user of prosecution.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You also supply cases that are often very desirable. There is competition between state and federal. We can explore the reasons why there may be in a couple of minutes. But there are. Do you see this as something that you can use to your advantage? Can you play off one against another? Can you get them to do things for you that would be very helpful, because each one has to provide a service in order for you to attract your cases?
Well, look, the bottom line is, when you say using to my advantage, my bottom line, honestly, is solving crime, preventing crime. So if I'm sitting at ComStat, which many of you may know it's a weekly program that goes on the New York City Police Department, where bosses are put on the spot and confronted with rising crime stats and challenged as to why those stats are going downhill. If I'm at ComStat and I see a slew of unsolved shootings in Brooklyn South, I am going to raise the question as to why haven't these cases gone federal into a federal racketeering prosecution? Because from my standpoint, as a former Manhattan ADA who prosecuted shootings and murders, and as a former AUSA who did federal RICO prosecutions, I know that there are situations where it's just better to go federal.
And why is it better to go federal?
Because if you've got a slew of shootings that are unsolved, and you know generally the group of people who's doing it, and as was the case in the example I'm giving, there are witnesses who are being shot as well, it's better to use the federal racketeering laws. You can round up large groups of people, charge them with conspiracy or RICO, and you can go after them that way. I mean, look, let's face it.
Dan, do you agree?
I disagree. I disagree that that's exclusively a federal concept. We round up large groups of people also. We charge them with conspiracy, we charge them with enterprise corruption, and we do long historical cases, and very much like, in fact, some would say that the feds patterned their violent gang program after what Bob Morgenthau started doing in the early 90s. So I disagree as a general concept. Of course I agree as to specific cases. There are evidentiary problems that state prosecutors have, most importantly, accomplice corroboration.
New York State.
Sure. Yeah. Many, many federal murder, native racketeering, or RICO prosecutions are, you know, based on the two different cooperators saying that the same person committed the murder, and, you know, some incidental evidence that it happened, that the police department crime scene unit says it happened the way the cooperators say it happened. And that's a typical, pretty typical federal murder case. You can't bring that in the state. And so, of course, there are certain types of cases, and I don't blame the NYPD in the slightest for trying to use all the tools available to them. But as I think Pat said, you know, we do homicide very well. That's what we know how to do. And if it's a case that we can make, we prefer to make it.
Ask him what he thought 5 years ago.
What did you think 5 years ago?
Well, that's not a fair question. I'm a lawyer.
Tracy, you've listened to Judge Johnson, and it's not just the fact that he is turning slightly gray that suggests that he is a very wise man, but you've listened to his
God
words.
God is my baba.
You've listened to his words, and you think maybe it is a good idea that federal and state, local, ought to get together and have some protocols to decide who ought to take what kinds of cases. And they've asked you, as a professor at Yale, to come in and moderate this issue. Is it a good idea? Have you worked on this in the past? Have you seen cooperation between state and federal? And do you think it can work?
I have, and I do. I would say, as an opening salvo, that the city of New York could learn from the city of brotherly love, which is not Philadelphia, but Chicago. And one of the things I find really interesting about this conversation is the extent to which there are so many fights about particular cases. And I think there are two questions that have to be answered here. One is, who is going to be the adjudicator? And after listening to everyone here, maybe a first cut might be the NYPD, at least in a particular set of cases. And the second is, at what level is this adjudication going to be taking place? Because the way you've set the problem, everybody's fighting over a specific case. All this is happening at the retail level. And the concern, I think, at least as an outsider looking, concerned with questions of institutional design, is you've got prosecutors who are wrapped up in particular cases and not paying attention to wholesale problems, which are how do the various law enforcement agencies that include prosecutors as well as police address basic crime problems, whether we're talking about terrorism or, in the case of NYPD generally, crime, and there ought to be some kind of coordinating mechanism. Now, in the city that I come from, that coordination actually takes place primarily at the behest, I think, of the U.S. Attorney's Office, because they are humble, as you saw today. It works when there's somebody who's willing to lead by being a servant. If you don't have someone in that position, I think this coordination issue becomes incredibly difficult, and you know, maybe there's no hope for you guys.
Well, I think that using the burritos example, though, may leave a misleading impression. I don't believe, from where I sit, that this is a major problem in a lot of cases. I think this is a sporadic problem in some cases. So the idea of a coordinating council, I think, is one that could be explored. But I also think
all right, let's explore.
But it needs to be prospective, right? I mean, in other words, it shouldn't be organized around solving particular problems. Particular cases, it should be organized around. We have, for example, as Pat mentioned, a gang violence problem, and we're going to decide beforehand that these kinds of cases will be prosecuted federally as a general matter. These kinds of cases will be prosecuted at the state level. And by the way, plug for data analysis, you can figure out exactly in which cases federal prosecution makes sense, and often it's not the cases in which most federal prosecutors typically think make sense. In other words, more federal cases don't always make more sense just because the penalties are greater. And I can prove that to you.
Well, all right. You may have to, because we're going to convene this group. We have federal prosecutors, Harry Littman. We have a state prosecutor, Dan Alonzo. We've asked the police to join in because we'd like to hear their point of view. We've actually even invited defense in because they can play an important role in this, and they're going to be affected by the outcome of what is occurring. And of course, Judge Johnson is always invited to appear at every panel because it makes the panel more interesting and more exciting and more fun. So here we are, and we have to decide what should we take into account? Is it sentences? Is it accomplice corroboration? How do we decide ahead of time? Because Judge Johnson says, put together a set of protocols so we know when there is an issue that comes up, how we deal with the problem, and we don't have to do it on an ad hoc basis all the time and let Paul run in and get his client the best deal at the expense of somebody else. Anybody want to start?
First, I want to second what Dan said. I do agree with him that the Burides case got a lot of attention. When there is a flare-up, the press pays attention. But by and large, it's pretty rare. It doesn't, in my experience, on both sides, federal and state, it just didn't happen that much.
Judge Johnson, was it a rarity when you were a federal prosecutor and you ran the narcotics office in New York?
It happened all the time. And I've got the scars to prove it. Now, one of the things I think that helped after a sit down with the Phoebes and the DEA, I made the decision on a particular case that I had that you get the best bang for the buck if the case were prosecuted in the federal system. But I made that decision. And I had one of my prosecutors, state prosecutor, cross-designated as a special assistant United States attorney, and the prosecutor prosecuted that case with an assistant United States attorney. So it was a joint thing. But it took a lot of concentrated goodwill on behalf of both sides, the state prosecutor and the federal prosecutor.
Well, everybody's
Ron,
saying.
I want to try to harmonize what Tracy's saying, the judge is saying, by underscoring this notion of at what level. Because of course it happens on a weekly basis that some state prosecutor and some federal prosecutor hate each other and hate each other's guts for life because they've taken away cases that they've been working on. And the most, I hope, fanciful but alarming aspect of both hypos you've used so far isn't just the debacle of the individual cases, but the punchline of, and Morgenthau and Hogan didn't talk to each other for 10 years. And so would, kept it going for 2 decades. The whole point, what's missing purposely and usefully from your hypo, is the perspectives both of the long term and people who have to be cooperating down the line, but also some kind of supervisory level where it's actually the DA and US attorney or certain supervisors with heads of agencies who are talking this through and trying to have both set out principles and then apply them. And I think it's at that level, which has become much more robust in both the federal and state systems in the last 10 or 15 years, that it's true as Pat said, that you have a handful of true and hopefully decorous turf battles in a given set of years that are, as opposed to the level of the actual line prosecutors, who sure have been gunning for this, have sweat equity, a concept, by the way, that I think should not, carries way too much weight in these kinds of battles, but I can get to that.
Well, why don't you get to that so that we can talk about what are the issues that ought to be thought about in designing protocols as to who takes what case.
Okay. Comparative advantage and intensity of interest is what ought to be thought about. Sweat equity is what comes up, and I had these sorts of discussions with both the Eastern District and Southern District when we were the teeny little U.S. Attorney's Office from the Western District of Pennsylvania. And you often confronted this argument, oh, we've been putting in all this time and we have a lot of sweat equity. And it can create perverse incentives for, you want to kind of get your hooks into a case, just quickly put people on and start doing some work. What I think ought to govern is comparative advantage, is either jurisdiction better situated, including in its agencies, to pursue the prosecution, and intensity of interest. It actually sounds to me, in the case that you talked about, that the feds ought to step aside. If it's really a case that the people of New York have decided somebody ought to be in jail for life and the federal government doesn't seem to have that strong an interest, I'd be inclined to defer.
Can I jump in right here?
Yes, you can.
Here's the problem with the comparative advantage and which agency is best situated, because you're still thinking about it at the retail level. Right, and so we still have the level problem. You can do it that way, and it's not going to be, a huge mistake. But I would urge the panel, this is the outside adjudicator talking, to think about comparative advantage targeted at a problem area and not so much at a particular case, because then you're not that much removed, really, from the sweat equity issue. You'll run into it every time. And if you're gonna deal with the sweat equity issue, then you should think about basic economic principles like sunk costs you're not supposed to care about, which everyone always does, but it shouldn't persuade you.
Okay, we have a large variety of areas that we can talk about. I'm not quite sure how you wanna break them down, but we certainly have homicide problems. We certainly have street problems where gangs have taken over local areas. We certainly have organized crime problems. We have problems in various industries. We have white collar crime. We have securities fraud. We have 50 different issues. Are we going to devise protocols for each of those 50 areas? Or are we going to have a general set of principles that we can then apply to each of the areas in turn?
Well, some of those can be lumped together, obviously, but others don't. It probably doesn't make sense to have the same protocol for the securities regulations that we were just talking about. It might make sense to have a similar protocol for gang violence, narcotics, and another set of issues.
Dan, what do you want to consider in these areas?
I'd be a little skeptical about developing a protocol as to every kind of prosecution that we do. The flexibility, I think it was Pat that mentioned it, is really key. There are some areas which everybody agrees are state crimes, right? I think there's a statistic in one of the papers that the entire Department of Justice last year prosecuted 85,000 defendants, and that's 15,000 fewer than New York County. So, there are certain cases that everyone agrees, a regular street corner robbery, a regular homicide, everyone agrees those are state cases if they're not otherwise subject to federal jurisdiction. On the other hand, terrorism. We are never going to assert ourselves in a major terrorist case and say, because it happened in Manhattan, we should be the ones prosecuting the World Trade Center bombing ourselves. That doesn't make any sense in terms of keeping us safe.
Because John Moscow wasn't in charge of the terrorism.
We're happy to play a support role in those kind of cases. We have a role to play, but it's not going to be leading the way against Al-Qaeda overseas. So the question is, in between, what do we do? And those are, of course, the hard questions. Sweat equity, it's one factor. I certainly don't think it's all important, but if the case is not going to be harmed by being prosecuted by the office that has the sweat equity, I think that's a basic fairness issue for people who are working hard as public servants. So that's one factor. I would also say that, is there really a substantial federal interest? I understand there's a difference in federal jurisdiction and federal interest. Federal jurisdiction these days you can assert as to almost anything. You know, once upon a time a federal interest was, you know, true, you know, robbing an insured bank or truly crossing state lines in support of some criminal activity. These days, of course, it's extremely broad. So, you know, I might argue, and this is a controversial statement, but I'll say it anyway, I might argue a local politician or a local commissioner might be better prosecuted by a local district attorney who is independent, who has the independence to do it. Obviously, there are strong issues why the federal government should jump in cases where they don't think the district attorney can independently investigate such crimes. But in a case where, like the Manhattan DA's office or our brethren in the city, we can, then there are certainly cases where we ought to.
You know, I'd love to think it was, I'd love to think that what Tracy is suggesting is a possibility, and frankly, I want to get her card and talk to her more later. And it would be great to think that we could come up with some clear-cut rules, some policies that reduces the squabbling. I just don't think there are. You know, for example, Dan just mentioned local politicians perhaps should be prosecuted by local district attorneys. My last case before I left the U.S. Attorney's Office was the Miguel Martinez case. He was a councilman. And he pled guilty to stealing lots of money over a long period of time. I could not have done that case as an assistant district attorney. I needed national subpoena power. I needed to bring people from California and North Carolina into federal grand juries. It would have been very difficult, if not impossible, without that subpoena power. I needed to be able to get documents from far away.
But is that an issue about prosecuting a local councilman, or is it an issue that involves nationwide service of process? That is, are you arguing that that is a reason for the federal government to prosecute local officials, or are you arguing that in those cases in which you have to subpoena people from around the country, it is better for the federal government to handle the prosecution?
Well, it's hard to generalize because not every case against a local politician will require national subpoena power, for example. Unless I'm starting to sound too much like a Fed, I do think, I do think actually the DA's offices, prosecutors of the DA's offices are much better at lots of other things. Like Pat said during his opening, during the keynote speech, state prosecutors are real good with homicides. They, in general, look, there are exceptions, but in general, they get a lot more trial experience.
Does it bother you at all, or anybody on the panel for that matter, that a local prosecutor can get out from under what some might consider the responsibility of investigating corruption by saying, oh, it's not my job, I do street corner robberies, let the federal government handle corrupt politicians that operate in and around the city of New York?
Well, it bothers me if we're talking about New York, but I recognize that not every one of the 2,000 county prosecutors in this country have the resources, the independence, or the sophistication to do major cases. So it would bother me if you're talking about New York, where we can do it and we've been doing it for, you know, decades.
It would bother me, but you raise an important point that's hard to know how to take account of here. I think a prosecutor who says, oh, I don't really want to do corruption, maybe it's not right for me, is going to find a way not to do a case anyway. You've raised the problem of the lazy career servant, which you know, you have to...
I'm talking about the political. I'm talking about the person who says, you know what, I run for office. There's no value in me prosecuting somebody locally because if they're acquitted, then I've prosecuted an innocent person, and if they're convicted, their friends will come after me. What do I need this for?
All right, so that bothers me as a citizen of New York. I think as a you know, citizen in general, it makes me think that that's a factor that does cut in favor of federal prosecution. I put it in other words, in the general category of reasons that the feds will do a better job in a particular case. Though I agree with Tracy on this point that we do not do it. We have a lot of kind of working groups that do case by case, meet every week, what's going on, but not much concerted effort to actually think strategically about areas of crime and parcel it out in that way at the non, at the wholesale level.
Ron, that's one thing that Pat said that we haven't mentioned before. I think in Chicago they have these monthly or weekly meetings.
Monthly and weekly.
And I think that would help a great deal to soothe ruffle feathers and obliterate the lines of mistrust and things like that. There should be these meetings.
Well, we could have those meetings, I suppose, but this is not Chicago. This is, in fact, New York, and
they don't meet New York.
I want to expand it and make the judgment, but you know, who's coming to these meetings? So one question. I mean, I was actually surprised by Harry's response, and I'd like to get the other reactions to it, maybe, Paul. What you're suggesting is that the federal government ought not be pushing the local prosecutor to investigate and prosecute areas of local corruption, make them responsible for cleaning up their own mess. That they should just let them go on their merry way and say it's a federal, well, you know, there is a problem with that, I suppose. Supposing the feds get distracted on something else, like terrorism cases, and all of a sudden they're not doing that kind of work. Who is going to do it?
Well, I don't know. If the question is, Ron, if you're a federal prosecutor and if you think your local prosecutor is not active enough in political corruption, are you supposed to knock on his door and encourage him to be active? I wouldn't expect that to happen very often in this city. I think you just decide you're going to fill the void and you assign more people to it. It seems to me it's one thing to try to coordinate. It's another thing to walk down the street and say to somebody, you're not doing a good job.
Dan says, well, other prosecutors' office around the country may not have the expertise to do it. Sterling says he gets assistance cross-designated as a special assistant U.S. attorney. Why not the other way around? Why don't we have an assistant U.S. attorney who is experienced, cross-designated as an assistant DA, and let them try the case in the DA's office, getting and teaching other people in the DA's office who are second seating to learn how to investigate and prosecute those cases?
Well, that's happened for us, not in local corruption as far as I know, but we certainly have cross-designated assisted U.S. attorneys as special assistant DAs in the appropriate case. So we're open to going, you know, in both directions in that way. I don't think it would happen in a public corruption case, though.
Are there any other issues in terms of length of sentence, in terms of cooperation incentives, in terms of procedural rules, in terms of substantive rules? I mean, here we are, everybody is sitting and saying, everybody ought to cooperate and get along. We have this meeting, we want to design protocols, and we don't have any. And yet this meeting every month.
Can I ask about a protocol? Which is, I have the sense in this city that felon in possession of gun cases go federally, right? I'm not sure what the strong federal interest is, though it means that cops are making arrests, and if the fellow's a felon, it's in federal court. It doesn't cry out to me that those cases ought to be federal prosecutions. Now, I don't know these laws well enough, but I take it there's stiffer sanctions there. But that seems to be a protocol that has developed in this city, and I don't know why, and I don't know whether it's true in other cities.
I can't say about what's happening here. I mean, I've learned more in the last half an hour about, you know, family dysfunction than I've lived in my own life, and let me tell you. So I will say, with respect to felon in possession in Chicago, the idea of these monthly meetings are actually, the protocol was set, almost 8 years ago now, in 2002. The goal was to reduce homicide and shootings in Chicago through coordinated efforts by prosecutions at the state and federal level, through looking at both sentences at the federal level, but also simply the impact of federal prosecution separate and apart from federal sentencing, which we measured. The paper, by the way, is called Attention Felons, and it's published in the Journal of Empirical Legal Studies in 2005 that shows the relative impact of federal prosecution versus federal incarceration and other measures. And the idea is, in certain targeted situations, you would want to use felon in possession federally, not only because they might have longer sentences, but because the federalist system allows for incarceration outside of the local area. You can send people farther away. And there's a thought that that might be more impactful. Our study actually shows, in fact, that federal incarceration makes no difference over and apart from federal. Federal incarceration makes no difference over and above federal prosecution itself, which is an interesting finding. Now, if this is being done in every single case in New York, it's probably overkill. But you can use, through evidence-based practices, a way of identifying exactly what the pivot point should be.
May I just address the fact, though, and Paul's mistaken, it's not done in every or even nearly every case in Manhattan, and not even in Brooklyn, where it's done more kind of more robustly. But there are, I mean, guns are a great area to talk about, because first of all, for a simple gun, the state penalty is usually higher than the federal penalty. And we've actually talked about this with the U.S. Attorney's executives about...
is that in actual practice, the penalty's higher?
The actual practice? I mean, it's a mandatory minimum of 3.5 years, even if you're not a felon. So so it's a pretty strict crime. And, you know, 2K, 2 point whatever of the federal sentencing guidelines have some much more flexibility, and there's no mandatory minimum. But a more interesting point for this discussion, Ron, is that I remember when I was a federal prosecutor getting irked that local police were debriefing everybody arrested with a gun, and they were saying something like, you better cooperate or else we're going to call the feds. And then they wouldn't call the feds. They would keep the case in the state, and it would be a state gun press. I, of course, now applaud that practice. I think it's a great idea. But it's an interesting thing we haven't talked about, which is that there's a mystique or a perception about feds that sometimes can be, you know, cops, intrepid cops and FBI agents can use to their advantage.
Go ahead.
Dan, what does determine which of those cases go federally?
Well, we're in the process of changing some of those protocols, but for the last few years, they were pretty much stayed unless the feds had another investigation.
Well, Can I speak to how it happened in Pittsburgh?
Mm. Okay, but I need I want
how we determine what cases.
I just want a couple of minutes. I want to change the subject very quickly after this, and then I want to open this up for people in the audience.
Well, so very briefly, everybody was in a room. This was an exception of the kind of problem solving in a subject matter that Tracy's talked about. It was all driven by street level intelligence of the, in Pittsburgh anyway, 150 to 200 repeat violent offenders who seemed to be driving the most hardcore street violence in the area. And I think you put your finger on it and asking what's the federal interest. There isn't a federal interest in a pedestrian felon in possession, but there is a federal interest in being able with whatever charge, be able to target, hopefully your intel has been good for starters, someone who is among a really small cadre of people who are responsible for a disproportionate share of the violence in the community.
Katie?
You wanted to say something?
Yeah, I think I forgot. We were talking, it's okay, I was gonna.
Oh, okay, let me switch it around then, Ron, because I wanna say I've asked you.
Can I just add one point? There are other examples like this. There are child pornography cases that involve, internet activity, and those cases prosecuted in the state get probation, unless you commit what is a worse crime, which is going to trial. Then you'll get a substantial jail sentence. But they get probation in the state. They get very heavy mandatory minimums in the federal system. And I have no idea whether there's any policy as to who prosecutes those. I've often thought if you're on the internet, you should say, are you underage? Okay, are you a federal prosecutor? Are you a federal undercover agent? Are you a state undercover agent? Because the differences are huge, and That's one where one would like to think somebody would coordinate.
Let me pick this up. I mean, I think it is an important point to say that we have this entire group of experienced people sitting down asking for protocols, and we're not getting a lot of them. And maybe that's an indication that it is more difficult than you think, and that it's not so easy to decide where the cases ought to go. We raised some issues as to what ought to be considered, but let me ask you this next question and then turn it over to the audience. What if this is good, actually, this fighting? That is, the notion of sweat equity, I take it, is that people would argue we deserve it, but maybe there are incentives there built in to say if sweat equity wasn't considered, then people wouldn't have the incentive to work real hard if they thought that the case could be taken away from them by another prosecutive agency. And so you want sweat equity to be considered because you want to incentivize the people who are working. Well, likewise, if you look at the system as a whole, maybe it's a good idea to have fights. We have it in the commercial field. There are different corporations that are out there. They're fighting each other. They're not cooperating. They'd be indicted if they did. But as a result, they produce better products. They're more innovative. They don't get lazy. Isn't this competition a good thing?
It's hard to argue with that point, Ron. I think there is definitely a sense of competition in New York City for, you know, the best of the best cases. Anecdotally, I can tell you I had heard from federal agents in who had worked in cities where there was one U.S. attorney, which is every other city, and a local prosecutor who really focused only on street crime. And those agents would complain, frankly, that their white-collar cases, particularly the ones that weren't overly sexy, would languish for a while because there was no competition. The U.S. attorney knew that he or she was going to be the only person prosecuting this case. And so, I just anecdotally, I think you're probably right. I think there is a value to the competition.
I just have one liner on that, and that is that good governance is not the same thing as profit maximization.
It's wrong to think that even in the public sector competition doesn't work. I remember when I became chief of the criminal division, and one of the first things Mary Jo White said to me is the DEA was taking their cases to Bridget Brennan. This was a sin, right? They were a federal agency, and what were they doing? And the answer was they were able to get search warrants more rapidly, and that was the key to making cases.
And wiretaps,
right? And that was just the reality. And so it did spur us to ask the question, we wanted those agents back, right? And the question was, how could we do that? Were there ways consistent with running a good office that we could expedite search warrants and wiretaps for people where that was their lifeblood? So competition can have some positive effects in the public sector.
I take it there's a difference between constructive competition and destructive. So it may be that we could build that into the protocols as well and have overlapping jurisdictions without necessary agreements on everything.
Congress has done
but
that.
I guess we're not even getting to the protocol. So let me open it up then to anybody who would like to raise an issue. Yeah.
Okay, I've been a state prosecutor for 20 years. Hi, Dan. I found that this was all very interesting, but you're really skirting around what I've seen as the main issue, and no one has addressed the issue of respect. All of these problems can be worked out, but in my experience, the federal government has been very disrespectful to the state government. FBI agents are disrespectful. I've had cases where they tell me, I don't need to return your phone calls. I've had FBI agents sign my defendant out of Rikers the day before my trial and make him disappear for 2 years and not return a phone call. And all of those issues can be resolved, who has better resources and who can better prosecute cases. But respect comes from the top. And if you have a U.S. attorney or you have a district attorney who conveys an attitude to their people that we're stronger or we're better, you will never get cooperation. from anybody. And those simple issues actually define more of our behavior than all of, you know, all of these. It would be nice if we sat around and thought about who had better punishment and not, but we don't. We sit around and we talk about who treats us improperly and, you know, how are we gonna get back at them later? And that's the bottom line. And I think you need to address that.
No, I agree with that completely. I had the experience in life of going from the Southern District and following Barbara Jones to the Manhattan District Attorney's Office as counsel to Bob Morgenthau. And it became clear to me that at the District Attorney's Office that the only word worse than defendant was fed. And it made it really does make it very difficult to have good relationships between offices if that attitude is felt.
Paul, if I can give the flip side of that, I agree, words matter. And you know, there's a tendency among federal agents and assistant U.S. attorneys to use the term the locals to refer to the district attorney. That's not a particularly flattering term that we like. So respect is obviously, Tara, it's a great point, and I think that words do matter.
And if I could add, hi, Tara, good to see you. If I could add that I do agree with Tara's point that it does flow down from the top, and I think this is a very relevant time to be talking about these issues because, at least on the island of Manhattan, we have a new district attorney, we have new leadership there, we have a new U.S. attorney, and I'm not the only one who's commented on there seems to be a real thawing going on. I think I saw Dave O'Keefe here. I recently brought him over to meet the chief of violent crimes at the U.S. Attorney's Office. They're talking about trading gun cases back and forth. I hope he told you already, Dan. But, you know, there's a real thawing that could be going on. And, hey, it's never going to be perfect, and that doesn't address the point Tara made about FBI agents yanking people out. But certainly if those FBI agents hopefully are working with an AUSA, the AUSA will stop them and say, don't do it.
To be fair, though, Cy and Preet deserve credit for working well together. But that thaw, I think, goes to Jim Comey and Bob Morgenthau. It started to thaw a few years ago, and I think it's you know, knock wood, we're doing okay.
My name is Joe DeMarco, and I was an assistant United States attorney for 10 years in the Southern District of New York. The question of sweat equity has been discussed, and you know, sweat equity can mean a lot of things. It can mean you just happened to cut the first subpoena and you got there first. It can mean that you spent a lot of time working on the case. It can also mean that you know the case really well and that it may not make sense to take it away from someone. And I guess what I would ask the panel to comment on is the issue of efficiency in the administration of justice. You know, if you are a prosecutor and you've been working on a case for a very, very long time, arguably, not only do you know the case well, you know the people well. You know the agents well, you know the witnesses well, you know the cooperators well. You've established a relationship with a cooperator. So I guess I'm asking the panel to comment on the issue of sweat equity, how it should factor into decisions, and then if there are reasons why a case should either change hands, how you address that. I know in my own experience, we addressed it through sharing orders, through jointly signing up cooperators between the two offices and the like. And I think it's just important, and so I was wondering if the panel could talk about what they mean by sweat equity.
Well, as the guy who criticized it, I'll start with that. I think the question illustrates exactly the better uses of, or more compelling reasons for sweat equity and the less compelling ones, and it's essentially prospective and retrospective. What you hear sometimes is we put so many hours in and as an independent reason, I would agree with Ron that it's at most marginal. But all these perspectives, I mean, what you've articulated is a compelling case for keeping things where they are, and you could call it sweat equity, but I think it's just it's a very strong argument for a comparative advantage that it be in one, especially this relationship with the cooperator, and you know that's going to be really important. But that I would put under the rubric of why the case is going to be better served going forward, and less under the rubric that it often is housed in these kinds of arguments. We've been working it since, you know, last October, et cetera, and the tendency to inflate those competing claims.
Sterling?
Yeah. Years ago in narcotics, they had a thing called the DEC system. And if someone was working on a particular target, they would enter the name, and if someone else worked on the target, they would have to get in touch with the person who put the name in the DEX system. I wanted to know if that system still exists, and would that be available for non-narcotic situations?
Bridget? There still is a DEX system. I'm Bridget Brennan, the Special Narcotics Prosecutor. The new and not improved Sterling Johnson. There is still a DEX system. There is still a DEX system, a deconfliction system that is used in narcotics prosecutions. I don't believe it's used in other kinds of prosecutions. The reason it sprang up in narcotics prosecutions is because there are so many different agencies, and often there are overlaps in narcotics, but I'm not aware that it's used in other kinds of cases.
Yeah, I would just say to it, I mean, it's easy to say that sweat equity shouldn't be a criteria in the, if you're talking in the large at that level. But gosh, at the individual case level, it almost has to be or should be. I mean, I was the beneficiary, my client was the beneficiary of the fight in Burritos. And I have the highest respect for Mary Jo White, but that was a state cooperator who turned and gave them that information. It was state police who worked it. It was state police who made that wonderful tape recording. I don't know many district attorneys who would have picked up the phone and said, this is an insider trading case, we're bringing it over to you. So I think the sweat equity there really had to get or should have gotten more respect. I say respect.
And there will probably be an entirely, or at least largely, different set of criteria to adjudicate at the retail level. The problem is, if all you're doing is adjudicating at the retail level every time without any kind of prospective wholesale plan, then sweat equity dominates in a way that's counterproductive.
I agree with that.
Hi. Just a clarification. Perry Cadenoff, Organized Crime Task Force. People besides narcotics cases do use what's now called the safety net system. State prosecutors use it, the NYPD uses it, the state police use it, but the federal prosecutors and federal law enforcement does not use it, so it only deconflicts half of our situation.
Amy Leagow, Organized Crime Task Force. I just want to relate two stories about cooperation. I've been a prosecutor since 1985, first at the Manhattan DA's office and working for Sterling Johnson in the Special Narcotics Prosecutor's Office. And in the early 90s, I was cross-designated as a special AUSA in one of the districts to do a large-scale narcotics investigation. And the reason we did it that way was because it was the first time you could do cell phones, and nobody was really sure whether cell phones were tappable in the state of New York, which obviously now we know we can. At any rate, I investigated and prosecuted that case as a special AUSA. It was wildly successful. Everybody worked incredibly well together, the state, the city, and the feds. And we got incredible pleas before ever having to turn over any discovery, including 30 years on the top guy. And we took out pretty much the better part of the Cali cartel in New York in the early 90s. It was incredible, and thanks in large part to Sterling and his willingness to, you know, let it go the way it needed to go. 17 years later, as an assistant in the Organized Crime Task Force, I did a large scale organized crime investigation where I flipped an incredible informant who spent 3 years recording the top echelons of the Gambino crime family. Ultimately, it became clear that the case should be prosecuted federally because of the nature of the crimes. Once again, I was cross-designated as a special AUSA, but in that instance, the AUSAs assigned to the case decided that they were going to take it and cut pretty much me and the investigator that ran this guy out of the subsequent prosecution, to the extent that although 62 members of the Gambino crime family were arrested and indicted federally and prosecuted, the sentences that they got were an absolute abomination, and it was an embarrassment because the AUSAs didn't understand 3 years worth of investigation. There was a rush to indict it. They didn't include us to the extent that they should have in learning about the case, and ultimately gave away the case because they were in over their heads and they didn't want to acknowledge that it was a state organized crime task force that really made the case and state investigators and prosecutors that did the initial work. So it was unfortunate, and those are two examples of good and bad.
This is payback time, apparently. Yeah.
In considering where, I'm Meg Reese from the Nassau DA's office. In considering where a case should be prosecuted, I haven't heard anyone mention the responsibility that a local prosecutor actually has to the communities that they represent. And in fact, they were elected into office because on the principles of how they manage the crime problem, how they prevent crime, and that's why they are in office in the first place. So I want to ask the panel if you think that is a factor that should be considered in evaluating whether it's a local or federal prosecution, and would you in fact defer a case, the feds defer a case to the locals because you think it's appropriate for that reason?
Yeah. Okay. Harry.
Yeah. Just briefly, so I'll say, of course, and just add a couple points. And as part of the long-term relationship that we've all been advocating is best, at least in theory, and sometimes violated in practice, you want, as the U.S. attorney, to be sensitive to the position of the DA you're working with all the time, even including the controversial but human impulse of he or she needs to look good in the press or whatever it is, and you want to really be responsive to that real felt need, and they know when you're doing it. That's one. And cutting in the other direction, and this is the more sort of abstract good government point, but I do want to myself as a federal prosecutor, and I think it cuts both ways, just be aware of the point that a state interest can be served with a federal prosecution and a federal interest can be served by a state prosecution. But with that caveat, yeah, absolutely. Sometimes a DA has said to me, I need this one and we'll do it well. And that's compelling in terms of a long-term relationship.
I'm not sure that was the question. Let me ask the
question. Let's ask her
again, because I think the question was more as a basic matter of political philosophy. That is, you have local residents who are affected by the crime problem. They elect a district attorney based upon what they believe the district attorney will do for them, and to express their views as to what should be prosecuted, what not prosecuted, as it comes out in the campaign. The feds, what are they? They have some political person who was picked by the state senator of the party of the president, and they know very little about local things. You get Pat, who comes from New York, going to Chicago. What does he mean? And so shouldn't the, as a matter of political philosophy, not because the person needs votes, but because they express the will of the people, shouldn't deference be paid to that person? Is that a...
You got certain things. So for instance, in Nassau, you've got a tremendous heroin problem, I understand. And you don't have the resources you think you should have. So if it were myself, I would sit down with the U.S. attorney and the Drug Enforcement Administration, come up with a plan, and together we would do this. And if there was press, it would be the feds and the U.S. attorney, because there are strategies and things that could be done on a federal level that could benefit the state level. I don't think it's going to be a situation in which the feds are just going to...
I want to align myself with Meg insofar as I think her comments are consistent with a point I made earlier, which is about how to think about this at the wholesale level, coordination directed at problems and not at particular cases. And the problem here being that
One hopes that law enforcement agencies, and I mean that writ large, are paying attention to the problems that people experience every day, especially in high crime communities. And so their efforts ought to be directed toward dealing with that. One concern I have, though, with the idea that I think Meg was proposing, is that an elected official is better situated to be sensitive to the articulation of that problem than, or a locally elected official, than someone like the United States Attorney. I think that can be true, but we should also be conscious of problems that my colleague Sarah Sunbeal has identified, which is the ways in which elected officials actually shape crime problems through the media, through the press, may not actually represent the problem that exists. And so it becomes skewed. And it might be that an outsider that's not as, you know, locally sensitive or as, well, as you would say, as particularly accountable in an instance, is better able to guard against those problems. I'm not saying that that's your particular situation, but, you know, there are many judges who are elected on the basis of, you know, I'm never going to let somebody out in a death penalty case. And, you know, the public might be very, what's the word I want to use? Not enough coffee today, those of you who know me this morning, you know, might go for that in a way that's just simply not appropriate. So I do think that there's a federal and local mix that can outline that problem in a better way sometimes.
Katie, you're in a funny position this way because obviously you are, in a sense, a representative of a local, locally elected official. And yet when you make the cases, you could decide where to take them to a federal prosecutor who was appointed out of Washington or a local DA that has gotten the approval of the people in the county in which they serve. So do you think about that at all in determining where you take the case?
No, the bottom line is just solve the crime, prevent the crime. That's the bottom line. And I can see you've already handed off the mic, so you're ready to go to the next guy. But I actually had a question for, I think it was Megan. Are there categories of cases that she had, are there certain kinds of cases you're thinking about that should perhaps go to the local prosecutor? Public corruption?
Well, let me modify it. Let's assume that you're in a jurisdiction, we'll take it outside of, it could be New York or outside of New York, where the local community is just not interested in marijuana prosecutions, or they're not interested in pornography prosecutions, and they've elected the district attorney on the grounds that he's not or she's not either. And then the federal prosecutor comes in and handles those cases. Cases that have presumably are being prosecuted against the will of the people in the community. Does that play into this at all?
And that very thing happened in San Francisco. I mean, that.
Well, yes. Outside of New York, yeah.
And so it's a very rich topic, but there are national interests and dual citizenship, and there what happened there probably appropriately is that it was. Factored in it, but at the end of the day, the local U.S. attorney couldn't just make it a federal law free zone as to certain crimes, notwithstanding the feeling of the local population.
So this may dovetail with that relatively well. My name is David Jarris, and I teach here at NYU in the lawyering program. But before that, I had the pleasure of being a public defender in the Bronx. And being a public defender in the Bronx is kind of nice because you get a Bronx jury. And so I'm
and a Bronx cheer.
I'm curious as to, I mean, one thing is to say, yes, there's the political question of should your locally elected district attorney have some say in what gets prosecuted. But there's also the question of should the local populace be the jury if a case is lucky enough to go to trial. I realize we're talking about 5% of all cases. So I'm curious as to how you work into this calculus. The question of should a case that happens in the Bronx be tried by a predominantly white jury in the Southern District versus, and how that plays out.
Nobody wants to touch that one.
You guys are the real lawyers over there. I just write about this stuff.
And I'm going to
plays out cynically.
I'm going to add a friendly amendment to that. Let's add to that the whole question of dual prosecutions. So cases in which they have failed, or there's been an acquittal in a local case, and I'm sorry, the use of the term. But
local
the federal
cases
government
the,
then
the
decides
locals,
that it wants its interests vindicated and re-prosecutes the individual, Rodney King situation. Okay. Go ahead, Tracy.
I'm sorry. Raising my hand. I was going like this.
You know, in all the times that I've come across these kind of matters, I've never heard of anybody talk about, oh, this jury is better or worse racially than the other. I mean, you know, in the Eastern District, we had an issue of whether we should draw our jury pools from all five counties or just from two, or three rather, the ones in New York City for Brooklyn, and we resolved that issue. But I've never heard anyone say, what was the one we did, Barbara, Judge Traeger? The Yanko Rosenbaum, right, the Crown Heights case, Lemrick Nelson, we prosecuted him after he had been acquitted in state court. And actually there was, it was initially reversed because of an issue sort of like the one raised, but the Eastern District's decision to take it or not take it had nothing to do with, you know, the racial composition of the jury.
And that since you are Chicago's better.
Okay, last comments, and then we have to end the panel. So anybody have anything that they'd like to say to sum up? No, in that case, I want to thank all of you.
So we're going to take a brief break, 10 minutes, to set up the table for a sitting, not strolling moderator. And we'll start up again in 10 minutes.
Okay. So, like, if you're at the local, we're going to keep that.